afternoon and welcome back to Opera 101. I'm Leia Edwards, General Director of Holy City Arts and Lyric Opera.
And I'm Dimitri Pitas, Artistic Director for HALO, and we have a great class for you today to feed your soul some yummy information and some fantastic clips of operas that are tied to Charleston.
As you know, we love hearing from y'all, so after class today, we're going to host a live Q&A using Zoom's chat function. You may have seen info on how to set it up while waiting for class to start.
Now, we want to stress that there are no stupid questions, but rest assured, they will only be seen by us and none of the other students.
Anyway, enough from us. Enjoy class, and we'll see you after.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to all. Whether you're joining us for the first time or were at our class last week, we are very happy to have you. I am Margaret Fournier, and I'm very happy to share my passion for opera with you. Last week, we talked about the origins of opera and the fact that it was strictly a European invention. We listened to some excerpts from some of the world's best and most popular operas, all in various European languages. Today, I'd like to focus on operas in English and how opera made its way to America. Did you know that our beloved Charleston is the birthplace of opera in North America? It's true, and here's how it came to be. In London, during the 1720s, one of the hottest tickets in town was for an imported commodity. It was Italian operas by a popular German composer, George Friedrich Handel. Now we know Handel more for his wonderful oratorios in English, like The Messiah, but he wrote many operas. And this is a perfect example of what we talked about last week. Early on, all operas were in Italian, no matter what the origin of the composer. Yet while his operas were marketed to a sophisticated, well-to-do audience, Handel's music could also be heard in productions aimed at an entirely different crowd. In 1728, a new work called The Beggar's Opera took London by storm. It was written by John Gay, but not in the way we normally think of operas being written, because Gay was not a composer. The Beggar's Opera was a stage play that also featured songs and dances, and Gay did write the dialogue and lyrics for the show. But its music was borrowed from other sources, ranging from pop tunes to Handel's operas. The Beggar's Opera was an immediate hit and can still be heard today, both in recordings and on stage. What Gay basically invented with that show was something now called ballad opera. These racy works had none of the noble, heroic narratives of the mainstream operas of the time, and were instead biting, satirical pieces featuring predominantly lower class characters. These had spoken dialogue and short, punchy, witty songs leading to swifter narratives and many more laughs. In 1735, Charleston hosted the very first opera performance in North America. This was one of those ballad operas performed by the English Ballad Opera Company. It was performed in a courtroom above Shepherd's Tavern. A year later, it was performed in the New Dock Street Theater, the first building in the 13 colonies designed for use as a theater. The first opera performed in America in Charleston was named Flora. The title character is an orphan teenager left in the care of her malevolent uncle, Sir Thomas Testy. She's also in love with a man called Mr. Friendly, but the two can't get together because Testy won't let Flora out of the house. He has his own eye on the young woman. Now, this was a typical opera scenario, as described by George Bernard Shaw that we talked about last week. Opera is when a tenor and a soprano want to make love, but are prevented from doing so by a baritone. A production of Flora was revived a few years ago at the Spoleto Festival in Charleston. And because of that, we actually have some excerpts to play for you.
Flora! Mistress Flora!
Was performed in America in a few cities, but was usually the European model, still, of course, prevalent today. What did become more popular in America were the lighter operas of Gilbert and Sullivan, as well as operettas. These morphed into what we know as the Broadway musical. Broadway musicals really became the American version of opera. Some American works originally performed on Broadway are now performed in opera houses all over the world. Today, we have composers writing in and about this country. These works use music that is genetically American, based on folk music, jazz, blues, gospel, pop, rock, and all American forms, in addition to the traditional musical sounds and orchestration. We are going to look at one today that can arguably be called the greatest American opera. This is one with a definite Charleston connection. Not only is it set in Charleston, based on a book written by a Charlestonian, but vividly describes the gullah culture that had and has been maintained. Of course, I'm talking about George Gershwin's Porgy and Bess. For many years, Porgy and Bess was considered a Broadway musical. The reason for that was that it was first performed in theaters as a musical and nobody had ever really heard the whole opera. Gershwin completed the work in 1935, but it wasn't until the Houston Grand Opera performed the fully staged version in 1976 in honor of the bicentennial that it was ever seen in its full operatic form. I want to point out the major difference between a musical and an opera. There's a very fine line, but the main difference is that the opera singers do not use microphones. Some opera houses are very large, and the singers have to reach the last row of the top balcony with their voices alone, singing over a large orchestra to boot. Opera singers also need to rest their voices between performances and cannot perform every day. So massive cuts had been made to make Porgy a musical because of several factors. Number one, it was too long for the theater crowd. Number two, it required operatic voices who could not perform on a Broadway schedule of 8 performances a week. And number three, some of the music proved too difficult to sing in this setting. It took until 1985 before it was performed at the Metropolitan Opera in New York. Now, most of us know the piece or are certainly familiar with all the beautiful songs, arias, that live outside the opera. But if you look at the context of where it came from, what its motivations were, it becomes much more meaningful. Even those popular songs become much more poignant in the context of the story and culture it represents. It takes place in the 1920s and is about the unique culture of Black people living in an underprivileged area in Charleston. These people had remained a community and had maintained much of their former culture, beliefs, their language, and religion. Of course, they had also adapted to their new home and absorbed a lot of Christianity. The Christian ethic was combined with their original beliefs to form a Gullah religion. Now, last week, we talked about the elements of opera. We heard examples of arias, duets, ensembles, choruses. These were all in the European style and in other languages and music that contained traditions and music of each country. I want to show you the same elements now, only they are in English. More importantly, it is made up of many kinds of American music, rhythms, melodies, and sounds. Porgy, the main character who is physically disabled, in the original story travels around on a goat cart. This is staged many different ways in different productions, so you will not always see a goat cart. Now, Gershwin was a New Yorker. He was fascinated by the book Porgy by Du Bois Heyward, but he was not familiar at all with the Gullah culture. So he moved to Charleston, to Folly Island to be specific, for an extended period so he could study the language and customs of the Gullah people. He tried to duplicate many of the sounds he heard in his music. Let's start with the overture, or in this case, a brief prelude, where we will first see the atmosphere of the community being created. It is a typical summer evening in Catfish Row, a fictional black tenement. It contains jazzy rhythms in the orchestra, which is taken over by a lone piano on stage as the curtain rises and the community starts gathering around the piano. Different sound from the Mozart overture we heard last week. Now we'll hear an aria which is so familiar to all of us. Its context is a young woman in the community singing a lullaby to her baby as the men around her prepare for a craps game. This is summertime and it requires an operatically trained voice with a lot of emotion to sing it right. The whole community prepares to go to a picnic at Kittawa Island. Porgy says he will stay behind, and Bess decides to stay with him, and they express their love. Here we have a gorgeous love duet that can't be called anything but operatic.
Thank you.
don't know about you, but that gives me goosebumps. One of the most brilliant things that Gershwin did with his music was create an atmosphere and a community. The community is very, very important, and each character has his or her own place in that community. The chorus represents the community as a whole, and it plays a tremendous role in this opera. I want to insert here some information about the author of the original book. His name is DuBose Hayward, and he was born and raised in Charleston. Hayward was part of a prominent family. He was a descendant of the Hayward who signed the Declaration of Independence. Hayward's mother was a poet who became very involved in the Gullah culture. She was totally fascinated by it. She loved the people and did endless research, really immersing herself in the culture. So Hayward grew up with this household where the customs and lore of the Gullah people were a living presence. As he got older, he got various jobs, which caused him to see and live this culture firsthand. During his teens, he worked for an insurance company, canvassing Black neighborhoods, collecting burial money. Our next excerpts will be of the chorus, the community, and we will see this custom he learned on the job represented. Okay, let's get back to the opera. Now, one of the men is killed by another in the craps game. This is a very interesting and atmospheric part of the music. The crowd, along the community, along with the dead man's wife, is singing a very sad lament. To raise money for the man's burial, a saucer has been placed on the chest for mourners' donations. Porgy prays to the Lord to fill the saucer. This all builds in the chorus to what's called the overflow theme. It contains the wails that Gershwin actually heard when he lived in Folly Island for a period to study the language and customs of these people. This is called Where is Brother Robbins?
Gone. these people hard for to fill the saucer till he spill all over.
Jesus!
The Lord will provide a grave for his children.
Yes, the Lord!
And he got comfort for the widow.
Oh, my Jesus!
And he gonna feed his fatherless children.
Yes, Lord!
Out of the grave.
Hallelujah.
And set him in the shining seat of the righteous.
Amen, my Jesus.
Next, we move on to the picnic scene, where we hear from Sportin' Life. He is the questionable character in this opera. He's a ne'er-do-well who sells drugs. He's always trying to get people to succumb to the temptations he offers. He's trying to stir up trouble, as always. He wants to incite debauchery at this picnic. So he presents the community, the chorus, with a very cynical view on the Bible. This is one of the better known pieces from the show. Sportin' Life takes on the role of a preacher trying to influence skepticism. The structure is the common call and response from right out of the church, which really highlights the community, and you will hear them in a different light than you heard them in the last number. This is It Ain't Necessarily So.
A bunch of heathens in the tent picnic. Down the bead of tent.
All right.
John.
It ain't necessarily so.
It ain't necessarily so.
The things that you're liable to read in the Bible, it ain't necessarily so. Little David was small, but oh my.
Little David was small, but oh my.
He fought big Goliath, whoo, way down and dying. Little David was small, but oh my. Oh, why do?
Why do?
Sit down, put it in.
Sit down, put it in.
Oh, little white man.
Oh, little white man.
Set him on.
Set him on. Oh, Jonah, he lived in a whale.
For he made his home in that vicious abdomen. Oh, Jonah, he lived in a whale. Little Moses was found in a stream.
Little Moses was found in a stream.
Whenever it's possible, but with a grain of salt. 900 yards. I'm preaching this sermon to show it. Taint nessa,
Bess has been led astray now by Crown, her former boyfriend. She has succumbed to drugs and getting beaten and is now in Porgy's bed, delirious. Serena, one of the characters, is praying to remove Bess's affliction. This form of praying over someone is taken right again out of Gershwin's experience, listening in the churches of South Carolina. It sounds improvised, but it is. It is all written out, and this is another display of their use of religion. It's called "O Dr. Jesus." Ends up killing Crown when he comes back for Bess. Porgy is taken off to jail. When Porgy comes back from jail and finds Bess gone, he wants to know where she has gone. Someone told him New York. Porgy asks, where is that? Somewhere north of the customs house is the answer. So Porgy gets on his goat cart and starts out to find her. Things DeBose Hayward admired most about this community was their persistence, humor, faith, and optimism, which is certainly displayed in this finale.
Thank you.
is every bit as much an opera as those European ones that we heard last week. This work is truly a beloved piece of Americana and is held close to the hearts of Charlestonians who know, love, and respect the people in the Gullah community. And anyone who visits Charleston has admired the ancient art of the beautiful sweetgrass baskets, the sails of which play an active part in the preservation of the Gullah culture. Now, besides listening to or watching this wonderful opera, it's also interesting and enjoyable to read DePoe Hayward's book, Porgy. I have a copy of it right here. Now, Hayward's wife was a playwright, and she also wrote a play based on the book that was performed in New York. And I not only have the playbook, but I have the Gullah version. This is all in Gullah. So if you feel really adventurous, you might want to try to read that. In future classes, we're going to explore other different kinds of operas, different elements of opera, influences, and composers. We would love to hear from you if you have a particular subject you would like explored further. Thank you all so much for coming, and I apologize for the bad internet connection. I hope it's better next time. Thank you again.
Thank you, Margaret. Whether you live here or not, we hope you enjoyed learning a part of Charleston's history, which you may or may not have known before.
Two of the great joys in our life are theater and Charleston, and it's always convenient when passions intersect.
Now, we didn't know that Charleston was the birthplace of opera in North America before we moved here either. So we're thrilled to have you join us as we celebrate Charleston's operatic past and invite you to continue shaping the future of opera in Charleston.
We hope you'll join us next Tuesday at 2 p.m. for another glimpse into the world of opera. And for those of you who have questions and comments about today's class, please stay online as we continue the discussion.
And in the meantime, please visit our website at www.holycityarts.org. Thanks again, and we'll see you soon.